And he asked me for a title and just gave the title. Later, I realized and where I am talking. I'm talking on the podium of Nimax. So a small chill went through me because I know Nimax is doing a voluminous and pioneering work in the field of studies on mind, not only from the modern psychological perspective, but also through yoga. But still, I thought, okay, we take my turn. Whatever is there in the path of Patanjali. So we limit ourselves to the Patanjali's approach as to how to move this mind from turbulence to tranquility. Mind is in a turbulence, I think that we need not have to explain, because it's the experience of many, at least majority of the people, feel that their mind is turbulent. So much of thoughts going on, some sort of a compulsive thinking disorder. So about mind, I think to start with, this is at the NIMHANS, the Center of Conscious Studies. I think they are doing a wonderful webinar. I think yesterday's talks were also good. And today, yeah, the other talk on breath and mind will also be quite interesting. And I offer my prostration to Sage Patanjali, who has written 196 sutras in four chapters. And in that, I have picked up few to highlight the path of Patanjali to take this turbulent mind to a tranquil state, a state of deep calmness. How can we experience? What is the methodology as he prescribes? We all know when we talk about mind, this is a very famous statement, Markatasya Surapanam Madhye Vrishchika Damchanam Tanmadhye Bhuta Sancharo Yadva Tadva Bhavishyati. So a monkey is there, already a monkey. Many people refer this mind to the monkey mind, but it is actually much bad. The monkey from one tree to another tree it jumps, but when it goes to the next tree, it does not bother about the previous tree. But with our problem is our mind, even when we jump to the next one, the previous one also keeps bothering us. So if this monkey is bitten by a scorpion, which is little poison, and then if it is also drunken, and if a ghost moves in between them, then you can imagine the kind of movement in the monkey, and they compare this to our mind. So turbulent. Well, today we know that most people are having a lot of distractions. In fact, this is the, instead of calling it age of technology, maybe you can also call it as the age of distractions. So much of distractions are there today, and across the age, most people suffer from too much of distraction. The mobile phones, the major cause of distraction, and especially if it is not properly used, some very inviting pop-ups will come. And if we do not have a proper understanding of how things work, and also if we do not exercise proper control on our sensual organs, it is very easy to get into an abyss. So if one click, we can become sick. That is the power of the technology today. Of course, there are positive things, but negative things are not to be neglected. So many distracted, televisions, internets, Facebooks. And so this has led to, you know, even people, as simple task as drinking coffee, we don't do it, we don't really enjoy. As you drink coffee, you are on your email, you are on your WhatsApp or Facebook. So too much of distractions. So that is one of the main cause why the mind is into so much of turbulence. And well, this is always there, our attraction to wealth, name, fame, sensual gratifications, lot of possessions is always there, and this could also aggravate this problem, even if it is satisfied, because there is nothing called satisfaction in all these outwardly things, we know that. It will only increase. Then if it is not satisfied, yes, as usual, the problems shall be there. So in any case, these kind of outwardly attractions will really cause a lot of problems. So what seems to be pleasure is actually going to be pain in disguise. Well, this is the way today we are getting ourselves engaged. And especially in the youth, we see the lack of attention. You have too many gadgets. You are doing too many things parallelly. And the mind is always going outward. And therefore, we are actually missing the bullseye in life. We are going in the opposite direction. So bullseye, yes, while we accomplish whatever we want to, we have to keep our mind calm. Ultimately, whatever we do, we have to do it for calmness of the mind. Whatever we do is going to disturb the mind. I think that is not a task well done, nor will it accomplish something big. So it's very important to have correct focus. So we will look at this. The world, always we say that the turbulence is in the world, all whatever, family, relations, or office, or traffic. We talk of all these things and we say that, okay, that is all bad, and that's why my mind, as you see in the block one, is the mind. Mind is turbulent because the world is turbulent. Now, that is the reason often we give. How do you perceive this world? This is a very simple diagram which illustrates we perceive the world through our organs of perception. The five organs of perception: eyes, nose, skin, sense of touch, tongue and ear. And this information will go to the mind. Mind is the sankalpa, vikalpa. It does a lot of propositions, disposition to do it, not to do it. And it has no power to decide. Actually, according to yoga, although mind is one, functionally it is divided into four parts. They are only functional. It's not that they exist in separate entity. Manas, buddhi, ahankara and chitta. We will look at that in the next slide. But this manas is the one which interfaces with the external world. You get the input from organs of the sensory organs, then the decision will come to the mind through the buddhi or the intellect, then that will be executed through the organs of action. Karmendriyas will execute. These karmendriyas are, we know that walk, the organ of speech, then the pani, pado, that is hands and the legs, then payu and upastha, the organ of excretion, and the organ of procreation. So we very easily see that the turbulence in the outside world is exactly getting transferred to our mind. But Patanjali or even our Upanishads say that it is not so. It is not that there is disturbance in the outside, therefore you are disturbed. The philosophy says if there is disturbance or turbulence in your mind, you alone are the cause. So this turbulence, in other words, is called as the vrittis. chitta vrittis. We will see what this chitta is in the next slide. So the vrittis that come in the mind, because chitta is almost like our subconscious mind, where we have a lot of impressions and a lot of vrittis in the form of thoughts, they come to us in the conscious mind. That's what we feel. But what kind of thoughts come actually depend upon what are the kind of impressions we have in chitta. Therefore, it manifests as vrittis or turbulence in the conscious mind. So irrespective of whatever is the external world, environment, or whatever the situation is, it is possible to remain calm. The mind can be kept calm. That is the purpose of yoga. Yoga, chitta vritti nirodha. This is the classical definition given by sage Patanjali. Well, so this is the, we will take up not exactly the Sankhya approach. We'll go to a much simpler model given by Adi Shankaracharya, Drishya Viveka. So as you can see, the outside world is here, that is Drishya, that is the what is seen, and then this is the Indriyas, Gnanendriyas, block number one. I have just indicated it through eyes and legs, but it will involve the five Gnanendriyas and five Karmendriyas, which we saw, and all the necessary neurological connections, because eyes or ears, they are called Golakas. So ultimately you need that neurological connections, its interface with the brain and the somatosensory mechanisms. So all that is included or implied in this. So when we talk about this Indriya, it means that comprehensive connective mechanisms. Then they come to Manas, but Manas only receives and then it follows the command of the Buddhi. So Buddhi and Chitta. Chitta is where we have all the impressions, and our philosophers, including Patanjali, says that these impressions are not just belonging to this birth, it is from a variety of previous birth, a number of previous birth, these impressions will be there. Based on the kind of impressions you have and based on the level of your intellect, how well it is trained, Buddhi is like a filter. Whatever input that you get from Manas, you will make a decision. That decision will be conveyed to the Manas, and Manas will implement it through organs of action. And what is this Ahankara, block number four? Ahankara is that I-ness. I am doing, I am feeling. So that I-ness, it is not in the sense of pride, but it is more in the sense of Ahankara, in the sense I-ness. So this is one of the basic, as Sage Ramana says, this aham or I-ness is the fundamental thought in any thought. If this is not there, then there is no thought. So Ahankara, that is the one which gives the foundation for all these thoughts. So it is also a part of the mind itself, but functionally that is the difference. Patanjali differentiates between Ahankara and Asmita. Asmita is that Ahankara which has the reflected consciousness, seer or the drik. So Asmita, we will stop at Asmita because today's discussion is limited to that. We are not going to Vedanta. We are going to look at Asmita. So Asmita is actually the reflected consciousness. Consciousness is there. We know that there is Purusha and Prakriti. Sankhya and Yoga also start with. So Purusha is all this manifested matter. And then that, sorry, Prakriti is all that manifested matter, and Purusha is that which actually drives all these things. So Purusha does not interfere in any of these things that we all know. So this reflected part of this consciousness is plus Ahankara is what we call as Asmita. So now this chitta and buddhi play a key role in what decisions you take and what really happens in the realm of the mind. And this is not as simple, because the chitta has a lot of impressions, samskaras. Technically, they are also called as vasanas. In the sense, these embedded vasanas, when the name itself indicates, vasana means that keeps emitting. So based on these things, whatever input that we get from the manas, our judgment or decisions will be made through buddhi or viveka. So what is this impressions? Patanjali said this is the cause of suffering. The negative impressions if you have, that is the cause of suffering. Because all your thoughts will be modulated through that negative impressions, and therefore that's how you get into a lot of emotional problems also, and the mind becomes turbulent. The more the kind of negative impressions we have, the more is the turbulence that we feel. So it's essentially boils down to handling this impressions that we have in our chitta. How do we overcome these impressions? There are various techniques, because we have to find out whether what kind of impressions are active in it, then how to distance from it, then how to weaken the impressions, then how to take them to the dormant state, then the advanced stage of how to burn the seeds of negative chitta so that they never ever again sprout. But now we will look at what is this approach to be followed. First, we should understand that the negative impressions are fivefold. Five: avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha, kleshaha. This is what Patanjali says. And avidya is, he calls it as the adhima klesha, that is the root of all kleshas. So raga is sukhanushayi raga, which means the tendency of attraction. We can put it as sensual gratifications. Dvesha is hatred. And asmita is that not recognizing our true self. So that is the manifestation of the ego. Then abhinivesha is fear, especially the fear of losing the body, or passionately clinging to this body. And avidya is not knowing what is or confusing anitya to be nitya, confusing pain to be pleasure. These are all avidya, the ignorance. To remove all these things, Patanjali says there is a simple technique, abhyasa vairagyabhyam pan nirodha. He makes this categorical statement that you can achieve that chitta vritti nirodha only through study, practice, and dispassion. No one can bypass this. There is no shortcut. This is the only thing that is available. Abhyasa vairagyabhyam tan nirodha. In fact, it goes further. He defines that satu dirgha kala nairantarya satkara sevito drudha bhumihi. He gives characteristics of abhyasa, that it has to be steady, it has to be regular every day for a long time, and with that enthusiastic, supportive life structure. Then vairagya drushta anushravika vishaya vitrishnasya vishikara sangina vairagyam. Drushta anushravika means whatever we see and hear, and of course this is extended to all the pancha gnanendriyas. Although only eyes and ears are implied here, others are also implied. So whatever we see, hear, touch, etc., many times we get caught in that. Either we develop raga or we develop dvesha towards them, and they all leave an impression, and that can cause or lead to suffering, which we call here as the turbulence of the mind. So this has to be overcome. So Patanjali says that there is a methodological approach to do that, for which we will have to just look at this small background, because this is going to be of use for us in our future slides and discussion. Number one is, you know, in what the prakriti is there, when everything is balanced, there is no creation, and then the mahat is created, then there are three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas, and if they are in balance, there is no creation. Any imbalance will create creation. And the first one is that you have the, you can see the right side corner, you have panchatanmatras, shabda, rasa, rupa, gandha, panchatanmatras, the sight, hearing, smell, taste, and touch. And sukshma panchamahabhutas. The sukshma panchamahabhutas means they are not the manifested or not perceivable by our organs of perception, but they are created, and they lead to this panchamahabhutas, which we are all made up of. For example, the whole world, you can see this picture, including our mind, etc. Everything is made up of this panchamahabhutas. That is why in yoga we see that mind is also an insentient thing. Only sentient thing is the purusha. Anyway, so we call this as the whole thing as whatever is gross, that is called as grahya. Grahya one, perceivable. Okay, these are perceivable. We can perceive our mind, what is happening. Mind is known, and other things as we know, the world, etc., is all gross, visible. Then you have the grahya two. This is also graspable, but they are subtle. They are subtle. Whatever tanmatras, the smell, the touch, etc., what you call as the inner qualia, they are graspable. So that we classify it as grahya two, just to ensure that they are subtle. One is gross, another is subtle. Then what is this grahana? Grahana means the instrument which enables this grasping. The instrument that enables this grasping is actually the ahankara. Please remember, this ahankara, that I-ness. In fact, even during sleep, we see that the ahankara merges. That's how we don't know anything, deep sleep. Although a lot of things happen in the subconscious and the etc., we don't know because ahankara is not there. So when the ahankara comes up, that's the basis. Through that, you know, everything, other thoughts emerge. So the fundamental. So this technically is called grahana, the instrument. And then grahitru. Grahitru means the perceiver or the grasper. That is asmita. Because asmita is a part of the mind, ahankara itself, but it is reflected consciousness. Because unless there is consciousness, there is no way you can know. So that is the whole idea. So we have this grahya, grahana, grahitru. Now this is what it is. Everything is based on the cause and the effect. If there is something is happening in the manas, you will find out what is the cause here and the effect. This effect, what is the cause And this cause-effect relationship we have to trace back. So that is the inward journey, which Patanjali calls as sampragnata. That's our whole idea. So you have the grahya 1 and 2 here. Then you have the grahana, the instrument, then grahitru. So Patanjali talks about sampragnata, where he systematically takes us from grahya to grahana to grahitru in a systematic way. So basic philosophy here is that each cause produces an effect. Causal effect, cause and effect, we all know. Then at any given point of time, effect is grosser and coarser, more tangible, closer to the world of senses than its cause. Is I think very clear. Effect is always grosser than what is the cause of it. Then, for example, you look at this mud pot. Mud pot is, we see that, okay, its utility is there. Then, how did this come? This is the effect. What is the cause? Cause of this is actually, if you break this pot, you will have clay. So the cause is clay. So for this mud, for this pot, which is more grosser, coarser, which are tangible, but if you look at little bit closely, we know that actually this is nothing but clay. So clay is not that easily graspable. So that is why any effect is grosser than its cause. Then concentration on each effect leads to the realization of the form and nature of that effect. So if you look at the effect, you will understand the cause. Then when vrittis concerning that effect are controlled, the mind's door will open to the cause of that effect. So that is the basic idea behind this, what Patanjali calls as sampragnata. So sampragnata. Sam means well, proper, deep, harmonized, balanced, holistic. Pra means expansive, perfect, complete. Gna means knowing. So we should follow this approach to really move from the turbulent mind to a tranquil mind. So Patanjali has systematically given this approach. He says, vitarka vichara ananda asmita rupa anugama sampragnataha. He says, we have to move from grosser to subtler to subtlest. How do we do that? We do that through this process called sampragnataha. And it has to follow anugamat. It has a path to be followed, which is called as vitarka vichara ananda asmita. What is vitarka? Vitarka is something argumentative. We can call as argumentative samadhi of wisdom. Where the grass, grahya one, I have put whatever is perceivable, those which are grass. So concentration on that is vitarka. Then the pancha tanmatras, which we saw, which are more subtle, concentrating on them is vichara sampragnataha. Then concentrating on the very instrument, that is concentrating on the ahankara portion of the mind or the function of the mind, that is called ananda sampragnata. Then you look at the grahitru, the foundation or the main grasper, who is grasping the whole thing, that is the asmita part, concentrating on that is called as asmita sampragnataha. But it should be remembered that even to come to this vitarka, in fact, these are all actually the stages of meditative practice. And whatever may be the meditation technique, you will see that they will ultimately fall under one of these things. And for most beginners, this must be the path. Depending upon one's own exposure, samskara, one can start maybe at a higher level also. This is also very clearly said by many sadhakas. So here if you look at Patanjali goes into a little more detail with regard to vitarka and vichara. He adds two more subdivisions there. So this is what it is. This is a step-by-step approach. Patanjali calls it as the first one is savitarka sampragnata, samadhi of wisdom. From here, you must graduate to nirvitarka. From there, you must graduate to savichara, then nirvichara, then ananda, then asmita. If you ask, is that the end? No, that is not the end. But for our topic of today, and as per the Patanjali's Yoga Sutra, of this particular Yoga Sutra, I think this is good enough. So, it all begins with savitarka, which means on the grass. Take any object that is worthwhile. When you meditate on that, first you come across the grass nature. So, it is very important. Even to just be with the grass nature of the object of meditation is not easy, because that must also be practiced, abhyasa vairagya, because otherwise mind cannot hold the attention even for few seconds. The attention will immediately shift. Once the attention shifts, then there is forgetting. You forget what you are doing, then mind goes for wandering. So this is a very typical experience we see from many people. So it is important that first we should develop the focus. That can be done in several ways. Then comes the stages of meditation or sampragnata. Then once you drop the grass, that becomes nirvitarka. That argumentative stage is over. Then comes the deliberative stage, where we focus on the subtleness, like the sense organs, the tanmatras, that is savichara. Then when you drop even that subtleness, then you come to the stage of nirvichara. Then from there you graduate to the very instrument of grasping, that becomes ananda. Then you look at the grahitru, the very grasper, that becomes asmita. So now we will briefly look at each one of these. What Patanjali says is, we know first he said vitarka, vichara, ananda, asmita, rupa, anugamat, sampragnataha. Now in that vitarka, it subdivides. So now he has subdivided vitarka into savitarka and nirvitarka. So here he defines what is savitarka. Shabdartha jnana vikalpaihi. What is shabda? Shabda means word. Artha means meaning or the object. Then jnana means the knowledge or the idea associated with that. We'll take a simple example like cow. Now, if I say cow, the word, and we say, please meditate on this. What happens? The word what is spoken is the word, but now you will get the object also, because we have seen a cow, you know how the cow looks, that image or that object will also come, and the knowledge associated with that also will come. Now if you carefully analyze this, of course this I have shown because we are at the gross level. What we are seeing is the gross, the pancha maha bhutas here. Prithvi, apas, tejo, vayu, akasha. This everything in creation is made out of this only. So these gross pancha maha bhutas is what we are seeing, and there is a word. What it is, just a word. Whereas object is something else. The object is not word. Hope it is clear, because object will have something, if you have that, we can touch it, there is some hardness or softness, so many things, so many properties, attributes will be there. Similarly, the knowledge or the idea about this is completely different from the object itself. So nature of the object, nature of the word, nature of the knowledge, they are all different, but vikalpaihi. So what is happening? Vikalpa means they are getting mixed up, and we are getting, cow means we are getting this image, although we just heard that word, that has really caused so many amalgamation of all these three. Rather, they are related only in terms of cow, but if you look at whether they have any common property, they don't have any common. Idea is something, the object is something, the word is something. In the sense, what is object, we could have called it as some other word and things like that. So everything is there, the gross nature. But can you hold that gross nature itself? You see, even that is difficult. If there is no focus of mind, even to hold on to this gross vikalpa, where you know the whole thing is mixed up. And how did it mixed up? Somebody has told what is this cow, some ideas are given, so we have some knowledge about cow. So this is not something our own experience, but it is something that has been told or written, etc. That's how we gain knowledge of various objects, not necessarily cow. I have taken this example because it is most quoted. Even Vyasa quotes cow in his Bhashya. So I have taken that liberty of taking cow. So whole idea is, even with this, if you can hold on to that gross nature, even with this word, object, knowledge, the idea, that is good. That is, you are successful in this Savitarkha Samapattihi. That's a good measure. But that is not the end of it, because this is an effect. Now we have seen that from effect, we should look at what is the cause of this. That is what is to be seen, because that is the fundamental understanding. We have to go from grosser to the subtle. So we have to focus on the effect to find out what is the cause behind this, because only then we can have a inward journey. So now look at this. Now all the shabda, grana, nothing is there, only that object remains. So now there is no more argumentativeness in our mind. Just the mind is taking the shape of this gross object, artha. That's all. There is nothing else. So then it becomes, now all this grana, everything has come, how? That has come from our smriti, memory. The moment we use the word cow, see, we get a lot of memory. The cow, it has four legs, it gives milk, it is God, whatever. Different feelings should come. That is coming from smriti memory. So memory serves very well in the first stage vitarka samapatti. There memory serves. Now smriti parishuddhau swarupa shunyeva arthamatra nirbhasa nirvitarkaha. Now the next stage is, now if the smriti, the memory is completely cleansed and only artha, that object alone shines, then it is called a nirvitarka samapatti. That's called nirvitarka. There is no grasping except that just that object you are holding on to, that is called nirvitarka samapatti. This is very important stage. If this is understood, then the next is easy to understand. He simply says, Eta eva savichara nirvichara cha sukshma vishaya vyakhyata. He says that the same thing holds good. Just like savitarka, nirvitarka, the same logic will hold good for sukshma vishaya, subtle. Now, once you have the cow, you know it is a grass object that is there, which is made up of pancha mahabhutas. Now the next question is, you focus on the subtle. Subtle means what? The subtle means how you are perceiving the sense organs and the tanmatras. What you are perceiving? You are perceiving, let us say, some shape. That's it. The sight, that is the inner eyes, the mind, that feels that shape or rupa, or if it is shabda, just the shabda. Cow is only a shabda. The moment you say cow, you recognize it as only shabda tanmatra. But if the memory is not parishuddha, the moment we hear the word cow, not a memory, everything will come. So here we concentrate on only the tanmatra. How this, what is the effect of this, and what is the cause of this? How this mind is able to look at this gross object only without any other memory thing? How it can grasp? How, that is what you call as the qualia, inner perception. And that is possible through this tanmatras. Now we concentrate on these tanmatras, or the subtle mahabhutas. That becomes savichara. This needs little more insight. So that's why it is called the deliberative stage. That is called savichara. Then concentration on object not limited by space-time causation. Now here you should see that even when you are perceiving this, the cow in this example, from the subtleties of the cow as we are perceiving, we can see that there is at this point of time you are perceiving, so there is a space, time, and causation. So this is the cause of something else. So now when you are not limited by that, in the sense, when I recognize cow with a meaning associated, then you have all this space, time, and causation problem. But cow as a shabda, it can be any shabda. When you know that this is only a pure shabda tanmatra, nothing else. Similarly, rupa tanmatra is only, now all other labels will fall down. Then it becomes nirvichara samapatti. So once you do this, then you now go to the next level called the instrument of grasping, or the ahankara. Now we should always recognize that without this instrument of ahankara, we cannot say anything. I know it. I understood that. See, such statements, that I-ness, that is the instrument of grasping. Now to concentrate on that grahana, or the instrument of grasping. So when we concentrate on that instrument itself, that I-ness itself, then what happens? All the subtle and gross attributes of the object of meditation, they vanish. When all that is gone, then we enter this state of ananda. Here we should be mindful, this ananda is not as the same as chidananda rupam shivoham shivoham. No, we are not at that. This ananda represents the sukha that we derive. Now we do some actions only for sukha, even sensual gratification, everything for sukha only. Where that sukha come from? It is from our own self. Now instead of using these instruments, whether it is subtle or gross, to get the sukha, now we have reached the spot of sukha itself. That is the instrument itself we have reached. That is why it is called ananda sampragnata. So this is a very important step. To come to here is not easy, because crossing the, first of all, vitarka, savitarka stage itself, you have to focus only on the cow itself is difficult. Then coming back, now you see this state, whatever is the object of meditation, you can reach this state, because here object has no relevance. That is the beauty. Object has no relevance at this stage, because you have come to the very instrument. And once you reach here, then we have the concentration of grahitru. Who is this knower, or who is grasping? For grasping, yes, there should be the consciousness that is called as the reflected consciousness. That what Patanjali referred to as that ahankara, plus that reflected consciousness as asmita. And for this asmita, actually crossing the three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas. As you know, sattva indicates light, balance, peace, etc. Then rajas is activity, passion, aggression, etc. Then tamas is darkness, then ignorance, dullness. It also means stability. Depends upon the combination of these three in some proportion only results in various manifestations. Then when you come to this knower itself, you cross the, by crossing the trigunas, you come to that state of asmita sampragnata, which is the state of deep tranquility. And there is complete tranquility at this state. So it all begins with vitarka, savitarka, where you have the gross, concentration on gross things, like the panchamahabhutas, etc. Then the gross fades away, leading to nirvitarka sampragnata. Then from there you proceed subtler. That is, now you find out, for this effect, what is the cause? How am I feeling the complete object? For that, the subtle, the inner indriyas, the tanmatras. So now you focus on that. That will take you to savichara sampragnata asamapatti. Then the subtle things also should dissolve to reach nirvichara samapatti. Then from there, you will have to go next step. What is the cause of this? For this effect, what is the cause? The cause is actually the instrument itself. If that ahankara itself is not there, then there is no way of we feeling this effort. So that cause has to be found out. That is where we come to ananda. It is ananda because there is no link with the object, vishaya. Any link with the vishaya or the object, we know that it causes disturbance or maybe pain or pleasure, whatever. But ultimately, technically, it is a disturbance. So, because all that is delinked in ananda samprajnata, we feel that ecstasy, delightfulness. So that's what they say in many of the sadhakas, we find that. But that is not the end. Then we have to come to the next stage. Who is the very grasper or grahi through? When you come there, then you will have a very deep, tranquil state of the mind. But we should know that this is not also the end according to Vedanta. We should cross this and go to that universal consciousness, etc. But we all understand that that is the next step. But as far as the Patanjali talks about what you call as the tranquility of the mind, experience the deeper calmness, and this is a way. And once you become more and more established with this asmita samprajnata, then that tranquility becomes a second nature of our mind. So that is the process of this sadhana. And this is what I had to share with you. I think I will leave at least another 5 minutes for some questions if you have, because the questions will help me to maybe learn more, become better. So this is what I have to share with you. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity. I really enjoyed talking to you, and this has also given me some opportunity to hone some of my understanding.